Boomtown, USA. By the end of August 1979, the entire country looked to the new Houston. They saw lower taxes, lower unemployment, a brand new high-rise downtown, a population growth of over 1,000 new people a week, a city that had reached 500 square miles and still had plenty of room to grow. In an America bogged down by the economic difficulties of the 70s, people out of work looked to Houston. Industry seeking a better deal looked to Houston. There they saw a dazzling monument to the success of free enterprise. They saw the city of the future, the last bastion of real economic opportunity, the last place where the American dream was alive and well. These shelves contain more than 180 videotape cassettes, or about 75 hours of material. By August 1979, I'd begun to collect a whole series of videotape interviews with people from all over Houston who were telling me about a problem which didn't fit the image most of us had of the city of the future. I'll show you what I mean. And since here's a piece of raw material from one of the cassettes.
No nos han querido rentar una buena casa, no nos han querido, no nos sé.
This poor lady here, I come and see her. She don't have a bathroom, she live in a garage, and she don't have a restroom, she have no bathtub, and she's a poor lady.
How much she has to pay?
¿Cuánto pagas por ahí?
$17.
You pay $17, $17 a week.
$75, and no water, no gas, no nothing.
Another piece.
So you just can't imagine, it might be 10 or 12 people in one house.
How many people live in this house?
9. You know, to make it, in order to make it, money-wise, health-wise, and all-wise, we had to move together. We had to stick together, move together, in order just to exist.
Despite the image of the city, image that everybody knew, there was another reality in 1979 that appeared to be taking shape. A study was going on at Rice University on the housing conditions of the low and moderate income group. It revealed a reality that had been invisible to most of us.
Let's see what happens now when we put all these facts together, because the darker the map gets, the worse the condition. Yes. And then what's this one here?
The next map will look at income below poverty level.
Mm-hmm. Starts to spread out.
That's right. Those housing units needing major repair.
Well, look at that. Isn't that amazing? Yes, it's the whole city, isn't it?
The entire city, right.
Yeah, it's all this whole area of the city.
I perceive a real crisis that exists, you know, and a worse crisis, if that is possible, is going to occur unless something is done about it. And the affected people really are the low and moderate income group for whom there seem to be in a no-win situation. And we've been looking at the facts and the figures. We've been driving the neighborhoods. You know, and I think the first thing that I discovered was that the problem was endless, which astonished me only because this is a new city. You know, how could we possibly have such a large inventory of substandard housing when most of the city is post-1940?
The information we had clearly pointed to a crisis, but what could the public do to avoid it? Where should we start? What do we have to know? What decisions did people have to make? Santos and I decided to gather together in a video studio a group of scholars who were expert at looking at the problems of society. We wanted to show them the videotapes and tell them what we'd discovered and ask them to help.
And what you have to do during this four-week series is process out the essential questions. What do we have to decide? And what are the consequences of those decisions?
This present program is a condensation of 5 shows broadcast to Houston in August and September of 1979. At the end of this, you'll find out what was the major question the advisors felt Houston must decide as a first step towards solving the problem. You'll also hear how the TV audience responded.
We're going to start off with really having a series of facts on the screen that sound somewhat alarming, but indeed they are. For example, people in navigation telling us that the people are living in automobiles.
This housing situation is so bad that there's even people that sleep here in this car.
They're living 9 and 10 to a room. People are living in attics. People are living in garages. People are living in tin sheds without any running water.
Yes, there's people living in them little old tin sheds. The landlords, they rent them out, and they ain't got no running water or any kind of services.
From that, we then move to a series of people in the position of authority in the city who are telling us the facts and the figures.
Houston has a higher overcrowding rate than, say, New York City, even, to start with. And then you've got even higher overcrowding in the low moderate income areas.
It really gets to be a bug sometimes. It looks like it is 20 people in the house instead of 9 people.
We discovered that in those areas, 6 out of 10 of the housing units are experiencing structural damage.
See, the blocks right here where the inspector said that would and could fall over at any minute and was very, very dangerous.
How many people are affected by the housing conditions you've described?
We're talking about half the population, half the 70 population of the city, and we're talking about 27% of the land area of the city. The density is very high in these areas. You've got half the population and 27% of the land area.
Well, we're going to call this film The Invisible City because we believe people don't know what's out there.
They don't. They really don't. And that's a fact. Then you go to 3rd Ward, 4th Ward, 5th Ward, Acres Home. It's you just don't think you're living in the same place.
Okay, this was James and I driving around, really the first time, through these 100 square miles. You know, we keep just saying to each other, I don't believe it's ever going to end. And oh my God, it seems to be going on forever.
It went on forever. We kept saying, my God, my God. Here, you have every 4 frames a house, 12 deteriorated houses.
Are they all deteriorating in one form or another?
We kept saying, my God, my God.
These could have been pictures describing poverty in rural America, you know.
Isn't it amazing? It's very rural.
If this process is not reversed, I'm very afraid that people will be forced to abandon these units and we'll have a more severe problem with overcrowding and a more severe problem with condition of units because the more people that you pile into a unit, the more it's going to deteriorate. And if these units are abolished as a result of abandonment, then we are going to find that people are stacking up even more in the remaining units.
What is the rate of abandonment?
If I were asked to give a figure, I would say an average of about 3 to 5 a day.
Like I say, the mayor of this city, he goes gallivanting and jet-setting all over the country, Washington and what have you, and he's given the image of this city as the showcase of the nation, but he never tells them what's on the other side of the fence.
What most newcomers to Houston see is what has just been developed. One Shell Plaza, the Gallery,
right,
and Greenway Plaza.
Right, right.
They don't know what's over here by the Ship Channel.
They don't know what's up in 5th Ward. They don't know what's in 4th Ward. They don't know what's in 3rd Ward. They don't never bring them back this way. They always come back over there where all the finery is.
Houston gives its people lots of room to move and a stunning array of neighborhoods to live in. The standard of living is high in Houston, while the cost of living is low. One reason is that local government is efficient and taxes are kept low. There is no state, corporate, or personal income tax. It has been said that Houston does not tick. It spins. It spins with new people. 1,000 new people a week.
We have the greatest, I think, potential for personal opportunity and personal freedom in Houston of any place in the world.
Is it the land of opportunity, say, for people like the ones who live in that slum housing in 4th Ward?
Yes, it is. And the only limitation is their ambition, their talent, and their desire to get with it. It's tougher for the guy that starts on the bottom. But if he has the education, the desire, motivation, and the talent, he can make it in Houston. One of the reasons given by representatives of the minority population in Houston, why Houston didn't burn when other cities were burning, why there was no continued long periods of militancy here, was the attitude of the black community in Houston. Man, if you can't make it in Houston, Texas, you can't make it anywhere. Because Houston is there. It's yours if you want to conquer it.
In 1990, we are currently projecting 3,922,000 people. We're looking at approximately 440,000 for the period 75 through 80, going up to 480 to 485,000 for the five-year increments through 1990.
Where are you coming from? Where are you coming from?
New York.
Where?
New York.
What you doing down here? You visiting?
No, we're coming down looking for a job.
You gonna live around here?
Yes. I hope to, anyways.
How long you been traveling?
Well, just from San Antonio here, this will be our third day.
Yeah.
But we came down, it took us 4 days from New York
to San Antonio, and then you came over here?
Uh-huh.
How come you didn't stop in San Antonio?
Well, they didn't offer us much for money, and the rent was way high. We couldn't afford it. So we came here and heard of opportunities that were great here. So, plan to stay in here if I can get a good job.
So we tried to find out how many low-income families were moving to Houston, because we knew they would substantially add to the housing problem. Who is moving to Houston? What kinds of people are coming?
Generally, the survey data that are available indicate that the in-migrants to Houston are disproportionately young singles and young couples, disproportionately well-educated, disproportionately in the white-collar occupations. And given their age, they have disproportionately good earning prospects.
We had been told repeatedly by everybody in the establishment that, I mean, it in fact said that there wasn't a problem, there wasn't a housing problem. Why? Because the people who are coming into Houston are white, affluent, well-educated, young, aggressive, and they can buy the housing that exists.
There's a misconception, I think, in the city that all of the people moving in, this great influx that we've been experiencing over the last several years, are all upper-middle-class people. We're finding more and more from our waiting list, and we don't really have it well documented, that poor people are moving into the city because of the vast opportunities here.
The people we run across here are recent immigrants, and they certainly are low-income.
I suspect that we would rather not face some of the problems that this group bring to a city, the lower economic level group. I mean, we're going to have more health problems. We're going to need more facilities at the hospitals, at the public housing, at the welfare. And it's better to say, you know, only those that are middle income and above are coming into Houston, rather than really face up to some of the problems we're going to be looking at very shortly.
Well, I was leaving work about 5:30 Wednesday evening, and I noticed them as I went upstairs to an appointment, and when I came back downstairs maybe an hour later, they were still there. And our office closed at 5, so I just approached her and asked her if she were waiting for someone, and she said that she was. And then I checked, and that person had gone. And that was when I found out that she was the mother of the 4 kids, beautiful kids that were with her, and she had no money and no place to go.
I see. Tell me, Sally, where do you come from?
I'm from Kansas City, Missouri.
And why did you come to Houston?
For the opportunity of employment and better living conditions.
So what kinds of places did you find?
Well, the kind of apartment that I would like to have had would be so far out of reach. And the apartments that I could afford would be something like $30, maybe $35 a week. That would be about $120 to $150 a month. But the first one I looked at, the man said, we have only one vacancy in East LA. If you want to look at it, go ahead. And when I looked at it, the complete apartment was flooded. So at my own expense, I would have to clean the water, get the water out of there. And I told the manager of the apartment, there's no way in this world I could afford to, you know, I had no money to do that. I had enough to pay the rent and a deposit, and a little bit for food, and that was it. We have just been from one place to another, to another, to another, and so I went back to the housing authority, and she spoke to me and asked me, was there any problems? I told her that we needed somewhere to stay desperately. That's just how I told her.
Wonder, are there lots of people like Sally?
I'd say at this present time, today, that there are probably 100 people like Sally who have come to Houston to really be able to live. There's so much talk about Houston being a boom town, but being the place to go, whereas we know that the economic situation is the same all over the United States. So sometimes I wonder if our PR is not too good for Houston because so many people are coming thinking that there will be no more problems.
People are not going to stop coming to Houston, unfortunately, or for I don't know what, but it's going to come to the point where the only place for them to do is to stay out in the streets. Because you're running out of houses and rooms, and families can't keep just moving in with other families.
You talk about the waiting list. Approximately how long is it?
Well, the grand total is 14,363.
We're still struggling to meet the need that existed in the late 50s and early 60s, you know, simply because nothing occurred here for 20 years.
We built the units that we currently have under the public housing program in 39 and 40. And then the last ones were built in 52, or completed in 52. But the fact that the city didn't have zoning made it ineligible for a number of federal programs, including housing programs.
We're playing catch-up, which we'll never do. We probably will build, or commit to build this year, some 750 units of new housing. And while that doesn't sound like a lot, for us it's a tremendous step forward.
And what is the need, though?
Oh.
In the midst of this massive deterioration, we found several areas in the inner city which were coming back. The question was, for who?
No, but tell us about the family that's living here now. Are these the owners?
No, they're not the owners. They're Spanish people here living in here now.
Renting.
The people the inner city is appealing to today are, one, the traditional, and two, for lack of another term, the immigrants moving to Houston. They are not intimidated by having a mixed ethnic group in their neighborhood. They will pay $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 for a house next door to a condemned building that is abandoned and boarded up.
Well, I think simply the location is one of the problems or advantages, depending upon whose point of view you look at it from. The fact that the area is right here on Memorial, right by downtown, and has now what's a fairly popular or desirable architectural style and period, and that the neighborhood has basically a very pleasant and unusual character for Houston, makes it very desirable to people who can afford to pay whatever they please.
Yeah, well, what's the problem with that?
The problem with it is that basically, the people that can't afford to pay whatever somebody else please has to go someplace else.
How long has this man lived here, and where's he going to go?
¿Quieres saber primero cuántos años has vivido aquí en esta?
Son como de siete a ocho años que estoy viviendo aquí.
Okay. And so when the house is sold...
He's been here 7 or 8 years.
Oh, I see. And when this house is sold, where is he going to go?
¿Qué va a pasar cuando el dueño se vende en la casa? ¿Qué vas a hacer usted?
Bueno, pues yo tengo pensado esto, ¿verdad? De que, pues no sabemos, ¿verdad?, dónde vayamos a parar. Porque, pues, con suerte podamos encontrar aquí cerca casa, no podamos encontrar, eso no sabemos nosotros.
If the man sells the house, he frankly doesn't know where he's going to go.
So long as the present trends are extended, the middle income groups are going to continually engage in reverse blockbusting, are going to move into the low income areas, buy the houses, paint them, put up burglar bars, and squeeze out the current low income occupants. the housing stock for low-income people is going to diminish year by year, and they're simply going to double and triple up in existing housing stock.
All of the newcomers we met, most of whom had housing problems, had no problems finding jobs. You know, so industry was clearly expanding. The question was, where was it going?
So one day, James and I were driving down the street in Montrose, and we noted some very strange-looking housing. It was much smaller than anywhere else, a different quality altogether, and we wondered where it came from.
And we found exact duplicates elsewhere in the wards. We've put the two shots together here, just to give you the idea. Mr. Stephen Rudy of Creative Restorations.
Steve, I believe you're moving buildings from one area to another.
Yes.
We have gone out to used house lots, just like a used car lot. And we have bought used houses, moved them on site. You can buy them anywhere. The cheapest one we bought was $90. Some are old track houses. It just varies what day of the week it is.
Shotgun, shotgun.
Right, a lot of shotgun houses. Those are the one clapboard. You buy those for $90, $100, $200. And we move them on site, and we upgrade them. And then you have got a house where, say, you paid $5,000 for the lot, or excuse me, $50,000 for the lot. That means you can usually, it's a 10,000-foot lot, $5 a foot, you can put four houses on it. You can spend a lot of money on renovation. End up spending $20,000 if you want. You end up with a $35,000 investment. You can sell it for $40,000, $45,000, make a reasonable profit, and the person made a very good investment.
Steve, where do these houses come from?
They come from all over. They do come from the ward areas where they're clearing land.
Okay, this is one of the other ends of Lee Street, some of the nicer houses. But as you can see, there's one house already over there on the stilts, already ready to be pulled off.
Industry has encroached upon us. They're taking up all the space and for new development. And it's really kicking out the poor out of their neighborhoods.
These trucks out here is leading from Sudan on down. They went all the way down to Lee, where I'm living. And they'll have all this room to fence in and put these trucks all the way down. At one point, when my mother first moved to Houston, she lived on what is known as West Street. Okay, we talk of the freeway. So she moved from West Street to Swat Street. We lived on Swat Street, and we stayed there for so long. And here comes the freeway again, saying we want Swat Street. So here people go in a rush, and then a lot of them just were picking up anything to live in. We moved maybe two or three blocks away on Meadow. We lived there. They come through with another big freeway. Some years later, we left from Meadow, and we moved to Klein Street. And then when we got to Klein Street, here they come talking about a freeway again, and in 5 years, people are going to have to move. But they were getting closer and closer, so the people just started moving. So they did this. We moved to Buck Street, and we lived there probably so many years. And then here they come with a boulevard, Hirsch Road, coming through. And then we left Buck Street in a hurry, moved 8 blocks across the lawns up on Tyree, which is about 3 streets up from here. Okay, when we got there, the railroad, we had been there about 8 or 9 months, and here the railroad would start pulling the houses off right in front of our house. And so now the railroad has come from Tyree down here to Lee, where we are now, and they're looking at us again, and they want us to move again.
Well, where are you going to go?
Well, there's nowhere to go. That's the big question mark. There's nowhere to go.
So how many people are we talking about in this area?
You're looking at about 1,000 people.
She's been a fugitive from freeways all her life.
That is the best.
And now from railroad.
Urban refugee.
So the low-income double indemnity, huh?
That's
their
right.
Land is being taken away. And
their houses too.
And then what used to be a house that a poor family could afford and was could live in is now turned into a house that the middle class can't afford.
Great.
And now there's no place for the poor to go. And,
Because if you listen to the import of most of what's been said, what they're really saying is that one of the richest cities in the country, in the very rich country itself, the city built on the most modern of technologies, is incapable of adequately housing its own population. A half century ago, with the New Deal, this society committed itself to having no American citizen be ill-housed. And here we are a half century later, again, in the midst of this abundance and affluence, and saying that we cannot adequately, humanely house our own citizenry? I simply refuse to believe it.
I think part of what we have to ask is why have these problems been so invisible? Why has this city been so able for so many years to pretend that these things weren't happening? Why were we able to have a Chamber of Commerce able to make the kinds of statements that we heard at the beginning of this program?
I mean, how much worse could the situation become? We try to find out the underlying forces which were leading to this massive neighborhood decline.
So the next few areas that you'll see are areas that have gone through a transition, you know, where we'll find that land values have gone down, property values have gone down, extreme deterioration of property, and really abandoned houses. They're areas that are soft. Industry can easily move in, and the remaining homeowners are fighting desperately to keep what they have.
Now let me show you this. See all of this? This is a vacant lot. See it? Do you think that's necessary? You want to know why we have different disease? You want to know how this pollution and all come? Filth. Nothing but filth. Now this here is going to be ugly.
It's ugly now.
Yeah, it's going to be worse though. You have very few people that's concerned. Very few. If they
use them wicked late at night or early in the morning bringing their trash.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Because they feel like that they're slipping putting it there and won't nobody know who's doing it.
When do they come?
Early in the morning and late at night. They come and dump it. Because just like Ms. Griffin said, as long as it stays here, it's going to get worse. It's not going to get any better. As long as someone see you put some trash down, they are going to put some down too. So, and it builds and builds. And then after a while, we have a dump in the neighborhood.
This used to be a beautiful neighborhood. But everybody is moving out in the suburbs and places like this, and they don't care about the homes they left.
Yeah, they could afford to move out into a better neighborhood, and they
did. Well, this is why they be moving into a better neighborhood. This is why they leave out of our neighborhood.
They're able to mix, and they're mixing.
Yes, because if I was younger and I had an opportunity, I'd leave too.
So they rent them, and it's going down, down, down.
So you think it's the renters, really?
It is.
It's not mine, so why should I care? You know, they just don't care.
You catch some of these young couples or some of these old couples, they start fighting in these places and throwing and shooting and all of that kind of stuff, and they breaking out windows. Okay, the rent man is not going to fix these windows, continue fixing them. They tears up screens and things, and they move out. If you notice, when a person move out of house, they'll leave more junk in that house than you ever want to be with. Okay, when they clean that house out, they putting it in the ditch. When they put it in the ditch, that stuff stays there. See? And then you have a problem.
If they don't watch it, it's going to be high-rise apartments.
That's right.
All along Dowling and Elgin further over there, because some of those homes in there are just like over here. I've taking a survey. They're going down and they're boarded up, and in a little while that's what's going to happen. And further up here around Lamar, Dallas, McKinney, Clay, and all of that going to be industry, because all of those houses now are empty up there.
That's true.
And we are just trying to protect this little area over here, but if it keeps on, it'll be the same way.
Our little area. If we can get our little area fixed, we'll be satisfied.
The mysterious question is, why are these buildings abandoned?
Economics. I would say that is the largest single factor of abandoned buildings in Houston. That you own property in an area where you can't afford to use your own funds to renovate that building, and you cannot make a loan on it. The lending institution simply won't loan you money because they say the area that you're in is not profitable to make a loan.
It's called redlining.
We are killing these houses off. We're destroying them in their prime when these houses should be existing for housing stock for another 15 to 20 years simply because they're not getting what we would be called simple medical treatment. Last year, we demolished 596. That's just too many. We were losing too many structures. And we would say that of the ones we've demolished, more than 60% of those houses could be saved with an investment of anywhere from $6,000 to $10,000.
Who's going to loan you the money? Who's going to loan you $12,000 or $14,000 to fix up a $14,000 house?
We weren't surprised to find the older areas in bad shape, but what did surprise us was that the newer neighborhoods, many recently annexed by the city, areas of home ownership, were also deteriorated.
See, these houses in this area, they are not even 30 years old, and they are falling apart, and they are not old enough to be falling apart. I think that when these people built these houses out here, we were ripped off. Even today, they are still ripping people off with these houses. So you know during that time when they built the house, we didn't take them for 2 days, and now it won't take them a day and a half.
The reason these boards here are buckled out like this, because the house is coming off the blocks. There's no seals under there, no support.
No foundation.
Yeah, no foundation. They didn't tell me, you see, I'm a widow, and I didn't have anybody to inspect under there. And I just looked at the house and the inside, and everything looked all right. And they didn't tell me anything about how it was built.
See?
You bought this house new?
Right. I bought the house new. See? It rains in the den, bathroom, kitchen, and my bedroom. In the bathroom here, it has a hole in the top. We tried to fix it, but it still won't stop raining through there. And I can sit on the stool or take a bath, and I have the shower either way I go. I mean, I moved in the house and March the 28th of 47, and my husband completed what needed to be done, and it lasted well. And we've had when Coll came, we put a roof on it. But I don't get about $183.20 a month. So I have to do with utility bills and food bill and all of that. So I just try to do my best, see. I just really don't care. I just really giving up everything.
Those structures were not, to start with, good solid structures. Mm-hmm. Okay, because the people were and are poor people, they also have not been able to maintain the units. And what you end up with is the situation that you have now, which is a large proportion of those units in need of major repairs.
One of the rather intriguing questions that I'm having to face is that, you know, we do have a lot of substandard housing. And, you know, I really want to know, what is the cause of this?
A city must grow by annexation, and without building codes in the unincorporated areas, then when we go out there, we get the problems which are handed down to Mr. Johnson. So it would be great if the counties surrounding us did have a code that was compatible to ours. It would make our job much easier.
Okay. We're outside the city limits with a carpenter working on a building site. Why did you bring us here?
Well, I just wanted you to see some of the shoddy workmanship that goes into one of these things. I'd have to admit this is probably the shoddiest project I've ever worked on. The siding is pretty shabby. It's particle board with two pieces of paper on both sides with imitation wood grain.
Well, look at this framing. I'm absolutely speechless. It's completely out of alignment, huh?
Well, this is another example of a broken stud. It's pretty flimsy.
Look at that cracked plate.
Yeah, I imagine that they'll leave that like that because it's going to be behind brick anyway. What they'll probably do is get a sledgehammer and beat it in and just leave it cracked. And none of this plate has been treated. It's usually just regular utility pine.
How long do you think these buildings will last?
Your guess is as good as mine. I would say it'd be 5 years before they start needing major repairs.
Yeah. How do you feel codes in this city compare with other cities? Because I'm constantly being told that we were very late in getting our codes together.
I've got to agree that we were late. City has grown so rapidly. We were a little South Texas cow pasture, excuse me. And I must agree that we were a little bit late getting started as far as an inspection division in toto.
And what about the fire codes that have been so heavily criticized?
As I've said earlier, people are critical of something new.
But the building codes that do exist and the fire codes that do exist are not always enforced.
We had no fire code until 1974.
And we had over $15 million last year. That is, as a conservative estimate, in losses.
The neighborhoods we're going to be looking at now are going down for other series of reasons, and that is namely that they have not been getting their due services. At least that is their belief.
The last time it flooded out here, all that stuff we had parked there, it was all out in the street.
When it rains like this, how long does this last?
About two or three days.
Snakes and whatnot comes up about the water, all kind of rubbish. And it's supposed to put a drainage through here, but they haven't so far. All we get is promises. That's all we get.
How long have you been telling the city about?
I've known ever since I've been out here, the last 32 years.
About 10 years I've been renting here. So far, we haven't got any water from here. The most water we can get will be about 5 gallons in 1 hour's time. People can't even make supper, can't even take a bath or nothing. And that's our problem here. Everybody's griping. But all these people here, the Mexican people like I am, and they're scared to go up before somebody because they're afraid to be kicked out. That's the honest truth.
You can notice the streets are dirt streets, and rain comes by, and there'll be holes in here, and all they do, they just throw a little bit more shale in there, and that's about it.
How far are we from downtown?
We're right by downtown. We are the inner city.
A couple of months ago, we had potholes all over Houston. That's true. But these potholes never get attended to. The ones on the other side of town do. Where are the dollars going? Where are city councilmen? Where are you? What you doing with the money?
I don't think that anyone could deny that the city of Houston has been derelict historically in providing services to inner-city residents, most of whom are minorities. And in Houston, as in other cities, minority areas have been neglected. They have not received their fair share of services. And as a result, there has been a more rapid and devastating deterioration in those areas than in other parts of the city.
So it's very obvious that there's not enough tax dollars to maintain Houston's streets in that street budget. And I think that the city should tell us, as citizens of this city, they should tell us we do not have enough money.
Has anybody actually looked at what it will cost to upgrade the sewers that aren't being upgraded today?
We're looking at it all the time. We're doing it in segments, but I don't know that anyone has ever sat down and with an adding machine and added it all up. I think it would frighten the average taxpayer if they really knew what it would really cost to do the type
of
job that you're talking about.
Yeah.
The mayor mentioned recently that we needed a $400 million bond issue. I can see how that could be spent in two council districts, and I'm sure he would say the same thing.
We have one of the lowest tax rates in the country. We're known all over the country as a very basic services city, and it's to the point now where our basic services are deteriorating rapidly because of this failure to increase the tax rate.
What is the vision of the future if we go on this way?
Well, we're going to have potholes on top of potholes.
It's about 65,000 families out here.
Without a high school?
Without a high school, yes. Now, I know you find that hard to believe, but this is true. We had two senior high schools out here, and they closed two of them in 2 years.
Is anybody moving in here?
No, not now, and of course the ones that's here are going to move out. Your neighborhood began to deteriorate when you don't have a school, a neighborhood this large and you don't have a school. The young people is not going to move in. You lose your schools, then you're going to begin to lose your churches. And I don't want to stay no place, there's no school and no church.
The difficult thing for the people living there, like Mrs. Washington, is where would she go? She could never afford anything else again. She's exactly in the same position as the people in the Third Ward and the Fifth Ward. You know, if you've been a homeowner
and you're low income, you know, it's bad enough trying to fix up your house, that's a problem. But if you lose your house, you really literally have no place to go.
There appears to be certain marketing forces and decisional factors which contribute to neighborhood deterioration.
What do you mean by that?
And I'm going to explain it. One is anybody who has any sensitivity at all to neighborhoods, and certainly minority neighborhoods, would know that once you remove the church and the school, you virtually destroy the neighborhood. Mm. Now, this is what the integrationists, those who made the decisions regarding whether we integrate or not integrate neighborhoods, did not understand, was that the school and the church represented a kind of assemblage for recreational activities, and as a result of that, when you pull that out of a neighborhood, people no longer want to live there. They have no sense of identity. They feel alienated from the very roots that they sought to preserve. And when you destroy this, this is just destructive as housing, abandoned housing, and anything else. Is once you remove certain kinds of amenities within that neighborhood, you've set in motion the forces that virtually destroy that very same neighborhood.
And the houses go down too.
And the houses go down. The city looks at those areas differentially. If an area is black or minority, it just does not occupy a space at the top of the list. And once that's set in motion, then you see, you redline virtually those districts because they're undesirable. You cannot get insurance on your house in those districts. The police will not respond as frequently because they know that because of the characterization of that neighborhood, I don't go in there alone. And so you don't get the kinds of services. That you've got an interdependency of negative forces operating once you set in motion the wrong kinds of decisions as it relates to what that neighborhood is and what that neighborhood will become.
The Chamber of Commerce has indicated that we are the 30 largest cities in this country. We are 29th in the amount of money spent per capita on city services. And, you know, we pride ourselves on our low-spend, low-tax philosophy, and there's no question who gets hurt under that system. The rich are able to pay for private patrol services, for extra garbage collections, for gardeners to take care of city property in their area. And it's the poor areas that have the deteriorating schools, the deteriorating garbage collection, and so on. And it's back to the whole philosophy of the city of Houston that has worked well when this was a small, rapidly growing city with tremendous open spaces and inexpensive land and adequate water supplies and so on. It's a philosophy that is just not going to work and can't work in a city of 1.5 million going on 3 million and in conditions of the modern world.
Somewhere between 16% and 21%, depending on who you're talking to, of the entire housing stock of the city is substandard. And yet we do know that most of it is post-1940.
How could such a young, rich, and dynamic city allow the massive decline of so many of its neighborhoods?
But there's generally been an ethic here that growth is good, that Houston's going to come out better for it, and there's not really been a concern as to, you know, kind of who gets trammeled in the process.
So, I mean, how would you define the Houston ethic, for example?
I would say it was very much development for development's gains and disregard of the problems that may be caused. And the concept of government coming in and saying, look, there are some problems, let's try to, you know, to mediate this, is one that is a role that they've never assumed. It's really been the beneficiaries benefit greatly, and those that get hurt just kind of get overlooked.
As we know, it more or less started as a entrepreneurial enterprise on the part of the Allen brothers coming down from the East Coast and settling on Buffalo Bayou and selling off lots and blocks to friends and what have you in the East, and the city of Houston got started that way, and in many ways it's sort of continued ever since. It has been a place where I think the growth has been very much governed by the entrepreneurial decisions of particular people in the private sector.
We have the possibility of making whatever progress somebody's imagination is able to make. That's not true in most major metropolitan communities in the United States.
Houston is well known for having low taxes, for having an abundance, an apparent abundance of land at relatively cheap prices, so to speak, which can be developed fairly readily by land developers. They place very few formal constraints through regulation on the land developers, and in a sense they actively court them through the Chamber of Commerce and so forth.
there are many decisions left here to the private sector where the government feels that it is not necessary to make stipulations about what shall or shall not be done. Zoning is one example of this, and the absence of zoning in the city of Houston is another attraction for many kinds of business.
Yes, I mean, the lack of formal zoning ordinances which dictate where the uses go, of course, is one of the gives a great deal of freedom to the entrepreneurial interests. I mean, they're not told you can only build residential development of a certain density here.
No one is going to tell me what to do with the real estate I own. If they do, then they are controlling my investment, and they are literally telling me how much or how little money I am allowed to make off of that investment. And I am no longer working for myself and no longer have any control over my fate. It is strictly in the hands of others.
This, I think, is completely consistent with the philosophy of providing freedom for the private enterprise to act and for the marketplace to more or less dictate the form of the city.
Eliminate some of the regulations in the free enterprise system is a beautiful system, because it the most efficient producer is the one that can gets the business.
In the end, I mean, if you want to look at Houston's growth, you find that it really is the sum of a series of individual decisions that have been made by entrepreneurs or entrepreneurial interests of one sort or another. It hasn't been done in accordance with some overall plan or some overall concept, and really any explicit understanding or explicit notion of public good.
There's no policy set by the city with respect to housing. What is built is the result of the idea, the conception, which is of course created by the economic need and the economic reality of what you can build and where.
Houston hadn't really had any goals. Houston has not had to deal with such things as goals. The industry did its thing, and the city really involved itself as little as possible.
Look, in a city which strongly encourages the private sector, there is a city planning department. And the question is, what does it do?
Well, I, as a professional planner, I sometimes wonder what the word planning means. It's been used in so many different senses. Oftentimes, to plan is equated in the sense to control. I've actually had letters from planning directors and planning commissioners in other cities saying, we know you don't have land use, but how do you control the land use? As if control is a function of government or a planning department.
What is the function?
We're planning and trying in the sense of trying to provide information about the future. To be facetious and to the extreme, perhaps, let me say a parallel. We're planning the city like the weatherman plans the weather for this coming weekend.
Well, one of the things you give away, in a sense, I think, without having a strong formal planning process, whatever form it would take, and zoning is really only one form it might take, is that most of the decisions that are made in the city are made in terms of the self-interest of business enterprises, of the people actually involved in the decision, and they're essentially economic.
No one is going to tell me what to do with the real estate I own.
It's not that the private developer is a bad person and doesn't really think about the public at large. It's just that there's no real way in which that can enter into his decision-making particularly directly. And when you've got an equation or an amalgam of interests that's strongly dominated by one partner, so to speak, in our case the private sector, you find that a lot of the things which are in the public interests get short shrift.
I've brought you here to see Bray's Bayou in its all of its glory. The bayou, as you see it now, is actually at a fairly low flow situation. However, with 6 to 8 inches of rainfall over the Houston area, the bayou, in the matter of 2 to 3 hours, can rise 20 to 30 feet, almost to the level of that bridge in the background. Additional things that you can see in the background include part of the Texas Medical Complex. And these areas have been rapidly developed over the last few years, primarily because people in this area feel a certain amount of safety coming down near this large flood control structure. However, what has happened, let's say within the last 10 years in the Houston area, areas west of here out toward the A-Leaf Plain have developed extremely fast. And in fact, now the situation is that the laterals which drain all of the urban developments in close to the bayou can no longer function as they were originally designed. And very simply, it's a situation where uncontrolled development in the upper ends of many of these bayous, such as Bray's Bayou, is causing very severe downstream flooding problems. What happens then is that the upstream developments are allowed to come in and build at relatively inexpensive costs, and people that live in the downstream area are then asked to accept those additional damage costs.
This could have been planned, though, huh?
Oh, very definitely. Very definitely.
What do you mean?
It could have been planned from a basin-wide standpoint if, for example, the amount of new development, the amount of new laterals, the amount of new drainage were taken into account. But those things are not being taken into account on a, let's say, a month-to-month sort of basis.
What do we have to decide? And what are the consequences of those decisions?
I have the fear that Houston is operating on the basis of an uneasy peace, and that is they're making false assumptions. And that is that because we have no voices raised publicly against these inadequacies, this lack of responsiveness, that things are well in Houston. And I would submit that unless something is done and careful planning is made, that we will probably be facing one of the greatest crises in Houston that will not only embarrass this so-called growth policy and those who advocate it, but the very viability of the city. We can no longer tolerate these things. We cannot let neglect be long range. We must plan in a long range manner, but I don't think that neglect can exist on a long range basis.
The critical question is, do we go into the future mindlessly unfolding as a kind of natural event, or will this community begin to take responsibility for its own future? And that involves what around here is a very ugly word, planning, trying to look ahead, which we by and large do, by the way. Again, planning goes on all the time. What we're now going to have to start asking for is public planning, set out loud with public criteria that most of us can agree on in terms of what kind of community we want today and what kind of community we want tomorrow for our children.
So you think that that'll be the question? You think
planning versus non-planning, will Houston now turn around?
What question are you holding out for?
Well, that's very close to the question. It's much more complicated and difficult to get beyond to identify more clearly what we mean by planning, and I think that's part of what we need to do. The beauty of the marketplace, with all of its difficulties, as we've seen, with all of its dysfunctions, the beauty of it is that it's impersonal. The beauty of it is that we can talk about it as the system. No one is responsible. No one is in charge. And what we're now saying is we need a deliberate, collective effort to define the public interest. And that's something that this country has never been very good at. And it's a very difficult process.
The advisors in watching these tapes with us have concluded that the way in which Houston has grown in the past, dominated by individual short-term decisions rather than by long-term collective ones, has led us to the environmental conditions that we've been seeing in the last few programs, and that the people who suffer are the low and moderate income group. Their question to you tonight then is, should the public undertake a major role in formulating policies and plans to guide the future growth of Houston?
No one is going to distinctly tell those people this is what you can and cannot do with your real estate. Houston was not built on that premise. We have never operated under it. If someone went down to City Hall to pass an ordinance instructing the property owners in the Fourth Ward what they must do with their land, the real estate industry and almost all private enterprise in this city would be up in arms, myself included.
I think that the greatest thing the government could do is get out of wage and price controls, get out of any type of regulation of the housing industry, and let the market do it.
If the system was totally free, what would prevent, you know, the shoddy builder? What would prevent the man, you know, just simply plain greed? You know, all of those kinds of mechanisms from operating.
Well, in a free market, people buy something, and if it doesn't hold up, what happens? They're not going to repeat it. Maybe the person that moves into a shoddily built apartment, they move out and the word spreads. Eventually, that builder goes out of business.
If you let the free enterprise system work, there will be selections out there for the consumer to choose from, and he will choose the one he wants. In effect, he makes his own regulations.
I don't buy the concept that just because something is costly that you have to ignore problems, that you can't deal with problems because it costs too much to deal with the problems. To me, the problem is, if the problem is serious enough, you either deal with it or you don't have it at all. In other words, you either solve the problem or you forget the home or whatever it is you're trying to do.
I think we need to be able to develop a planning process which reflects policy in this area, and without it, I don't think we're going to ever get any kind of handle on the solutions for this town. And the clock is running. And we can get to a point where whole segments of this city are so outside of the process that it will become such an economic burden on this city that whatever advantages we may have from petrochemicals could be drained off because we have to pay for the problems we're not planning for.
If government becomes too involved in this, then you will really go into a no-growth situation, as has happened elsewhere, or a reverse-growth situation. And the city of Houston was just not designed on that premise.
How divided our society is, and is becoming even more so. How many people do not know of these conditions, and yet how important and significant these conditions are to all of us, not just to those people who suffer because they don't make enough money, because they live in bad housing, but to all of us. It can't be anything but scary, you see, to think in the future of an enclave of affluent people surrounded by masses of poor people. Now that, you know, just looking at your self-interest, that can't be very healthy, and it's not healthy. This city is growing in leaps and bounds, but it's growing probably faster if you count the poor people than you do the affluent people. There are aliens from Mexico, there are blacks from East Texas, and there are birth rates which are, you know, astounding. And in order to make these people productive, not make them, but allow them to become productive, you know, we have got to do something as to our self-perception of what our city is. We can't let it be invisible.
After this question was asked of the audience, 53 people phoned in. 49 agreed with the idea that we needed more public planning in Houston. 4 did not. But this is only a sample of the people who watch this program. It is not necessarily the perception of the people of the city of Houston.
This could have been pictures describing poverty in rural America, you know.
Isn't it amazing? It's very rural.
This could have been pictures describing poverty in rural America, you know.
Isn't it amazing? It's very rural.